and mysterious feeling about that car. But, yeah, wow. I become really tired. I get in the car, I turn the key, and I'd be, oh, God, something's sucking it out of me. And this really became evident around 2007 when I began taking, and really even before then, but it started to really make itself apparent to me that there was some kind of correlation to my fatigue and the car, because I was taking these long trips around North America and even sometimes sleeping in the car. And I hooked up a small sport utility wagon to the car, and one night one of the children left the back door ajar, and it drained the auxiliary battery, which is also in the rear of the car along with the main battery bank. Of course, you have the motor generator in the front of the car, and you've got the main battery bank in the back of the car, and there's a cable conduit that connects them together for charging and discharging. And of course, that cable conduit runs strategically midline, perfectly center between the legs of the driver under the floor of the driver's side of the car. And the amount of power that goes back and forth through that cable is on the order of 100 to 200 amps. So if you're familiar with your household breaker box, you know, you see a 20 amp, 30 amp, if you've got a 60 or 80 amp circuit, man, you know, you got some serious appliance sucking some power there. And the whole reason that motors and generators work is because of what we've defined as the physical property of electromagnetic induction. And that is, whenever you have the movement of a magnet or a magnetic field, when there's a change in movement, you have a corresponding change in movement of electrons in a nearby conductive material. So let's say you have a magnet and you have a wire. If you move the magnet perpendicular to the wire, you're going to have electrons start moving in the wire, and vice versa. So in a motor, or in a generator, you have magnets and you have many windings of wire that spin around within that magnetic field, and that mechanical power that's turning the spindle with those many wires, windings, you have those moving through the magnetic fields and thereby producing electrical current. So either way, you're either producing a current, or the other way around, the shift in current is producing magnetic fields. So you can imagine that 200 amps of current can produce quite a magnetic field blooming out of there. And over a long time of exposure to this, of course, one's body, and particularly those rapidly developing cells like bone marrow cells, in the case of multiple myeloma, wherein the stem cell is mutated, you can imagine that the probability of this is high. And that's what happened to me. So, of course, everybody thought I was crazy, that how do you get cancer from a car? And it's like, well, you're seeing it as a car. I'm seeing it as a combined set of systems wherein electromagnetic fields plays a big part. And this is something that, you know, people are largely unaware of. And even myself, who has an engineering degree and had quite a bit of study in electrical circuits and, of course, electrical physics, you know, I really didn't think too much about it until I started drawing a connection between my chronic fatigue and twitching muscles with the car. And you know, my children would tell me, you know, Dad, it feels weird in here. And then one day Ruby brought her compass into the car, her directional compass. And I said, what's her heading, Ruby? She said, south, Daddy. And I'm like, what's that? Head south, Daddy. Every time I'd ask which way we're going, she'd say south. And I'd say, give me that thing. Let me look at it. And sure enough, we were always going south. And I'd stop the car, I'd get out, and here the compass would point north toward the back of the car. So in addition to these fluctuating magnetic fields from the cable conduit going under the seat, the driver's side, there was also this static magnetic field that was so formidable that you'd have to step a few feet away from the car in order for the compass to read true again. And, wow, you know, I got the car. I thought, yeah, I want to save money on fuel, but I also want to contribute as a spending. If I have to have a car, I'd like to cast my vote in favor of something that is increasingly environmentally responsible. And I think a lot of people are purchasing these kinds of cars for those reasons. They're feeling like they want to do something to vote with their consumer dollar and make a difference, but they're unaware of the danger that is lurking there, and believe me, it is there. So, anyway, this Bruce Lipton guy, he outlines how the protein functions of the cell are affected by chemicals and by electrical and vibrational effects. And there's no doubt in my mind that that things like cell phones, wireless technologies, being in the proximity of power transmission lines, cell phone towers, radio towers, you know, if you're standing in front of a microwave, if you're even using a microwave, you should seriously reconsider what's actually going on there with the subatomic vibrational quality of the things that you're heating in there and that they're going into your own body. But the idea of, you know, when I was little, I recall that my bedroom and my bed were on the opposite side of the wall from our big old Kelvinator refrigerator, you know, where this giant compressor is sucking a lot of juice, and 8 to 10 hours of my day was spent right on the opposite side of the wall of that. And, yeah, so any of these electromagnetic kind of effects, whether it's household current, whether it's a high vibrational microwave, wireless technology, I highly advise getting it out of your environment as much as possible, and especially out of your children's environment. You know, people use these things and they don't really ask themselves how they work. How do these things work exactly? We forget that we're a collection of trillions of cells, and that these cells, how do they work exactly? And it's really important that we become increasingly educated about these things. In terms of education, you know, our education is a joke. What children are taught in school is an absolute joke and only perpetuates the enslavement in the matrix that we find ourselves in. So, yeah, so I've been dealt a real challenge, and shortly after the wheatgrass blend video, I celebrated that October in 2009, the anniversary of my hospitalization after denying chemotherapy treatment, and I took only a cortical steroid and just began super, like, juicing. I was gardening and doing what yoga I could do. I had I had shrunk a few inches, like I guess I shrunk 3 inches from 5'8 down to 5'5 because of the rapid osteoporosis. My vertebral bones dissolved so much that indeed I was shrinking in the middle, and I had multiple stress fractures in my spine when I was hospitalized. And so vitamin D, a lot of fresh stuff, some supplements, and I healed. And of course I stopped driving the car, and lo and behold, I got better. And so I celebrated that anniversary of being hospitalized by having a bicycle built and meeting up with a guy from Slovenia down in Mexico. He was already engaged in a worldwide bicycle tour. So I met up with him in Mexico, and I rode about halfway with him to Panama, halfway by myself. And that was quite an adventure, seeing what was going on in Central America, and meeting the people there, and seeing a real discrepancy between what the media was telling us here in the United States versus what I was experiencing there, meeting the people. And of course, seeing the influences of big agribusiness, a big consumer products business from the United States, including Monsanto and DuPont and Coca-Cola, and the displacement of the well-being of these people who were previously and not long ago growing most of their own fruit, fresh fruit. You know, they just had their own trees, they had little gardens, their own free-ranging chickens and so forth, and they'd grow some corn and beans, to the slash and burn and introduction of extreme monoculture as far as the eye can see. A lot of promised corn, genetically modified corn crops that didn't turn out and would fail, and the rapid erosion of topsoils, leaving the places really arid and dry. Of course, the water cycle's broken. The older people would say, you know, it's so hot here, it doesn't rain. It used to be, you know, there used to be many trees, and now it's very hot, and the food doesn't grow. This was universal, and really eye-opening to see the influence of crinkly plastic packaged snack products, and toxic soaps and detergents, all the little tiendas, all the little pulperias, just loaded with everything unhealthy. I mean, there's nothing, oftentimes nothing resembling anything that would be healthy to eat there. And of course, there's also no waste management to pick up all the, there's no practice or habit other than just throwing the wrappers and packages on the ground. And then maybe sometimes people would sweep it out of their yard into a pile by the road and burn it. Everything, metal, plastic, you name it. And so you can see what a great disservice is being done by big U.S. and some European businesses there in Central American countries. And that was in Mexico, Guatemala, Honduras, Nicaragua, Costa Rica, Panama. And, you know, Costa Rica, there's this thing called ecotourism, and it's just, you know, it's a whole other monster there. And all of this I could really discuss in a whole other show.